Now, China is demanding U.S. President Barack Obama cancel his trip to meet the Dalai Lama next week. It's the latest thorn in U.S. and China relations, already deteriorating over Taiwan and electronic security. And of course, we mentioned those bonds being potentially sold off as well. Now, the White House has confirmed he will meet the exiled Tibetan leader despite China's objections. Here to talk about it is historian and author Webster Tarpley. Mr. Tarpley, thanks so much for joining us. How significant is this going back and forth between China and the U.S. over the visit to the Dalai Lama?
It's significant, and it's a piece of incalculable folly once again by the United States. It's supposed to be a meeting with Obama in the White House, in the map room, not in the Oval Office, so therefore a little bit less than full head of state treatment, but still quite serious. And the Chinese have already demanded that this be canceled. And as you've just gone through, the People's Liberation Army, the Chinese military, their think tank, the National Defense University, says, let's have a comprehensive strategic counterpunch against the U.S., featuring a number of things, but prominently mentioning the theme that you just touched on, the dumping of some U.S. bonds. Now, the PLA does not administer the bonds. That's the central bank and other authorities. But still, that would have to be taken seriously. And then you wonder, why is Obama doing this? Who is this Dalai Lama that the White House now defines as a spiritual leader and religious leader, not a political leader at all, even though he's actually got a separatist movement going in Tibet? This guy goes back to Alan Dulles. He was a creature of Alan Dulles, that unreconstructed Cold Warrior and reactionary of the 1950s, Richard Bissell, CIA Director of Operations. Back in the mid-1950s, the Dalai Lama was the temporal ruler. He was the political ruler of Tibet, even though the Chinese had pretty much taken over the country. They let him stay in place. He didn't think of social reforms. He thought about organizing an insurrection against the Chinese with the help of the CIA. And it's very interesting, when he got that insurrection going in 1959, the feudal aristocrats joined in, but the common people did not, and that's why it failed. At that point, he fled in 1959. He took with him a gaggle of feudal aristocrats, landowners, and the super rich. It was estimated that 200 families controlled 93% of the wealth in Tibet at the time. And ever since then, he's been on the CIA payroll. If we look at, for example, the 1960s, the Dalai Lama says himself, I have to confess, I took money from the CIA in the 1960s. They were getting millions for the operation, but he was getting approximately $185,000 as his own personal stipend, which at that time was real money. His elder brother is almost universally regarded as a card-carrying CIA agent. And today, the U.S. taxpayer is paying $2 million for this clique and gaggle of aristocrats that he's got in northern India. U.S. taxpayer money, plus also money from the Indian intelligence, the RAW, the research and analysis wing. The other thing about this is, what did this stand for? This was feudalism. This was the manorial system. It's what you had in Europe in the Dark Ages. About 3/4 of the population were serfs, bound to the land. 5% were slaves. 15% were monks, many of them very poor. And the only beneficiaries of this was this paper-thin layer of feudal aristocrats, once again, 1 to 2% of the population. And the only middle class there was about 3 to 4% who were the functionaries, the officials running the estates for these people. Mutilation was the order of the day. The eye, the tongue, the hand were targets for this very punitive justice. One monastery had 25,000 serfs. It was a really monstrous system of theocratic despotism and tyranny, not at all spiritual. Now, for some reason, the people in Hollywood, very important part of the Democratic Party base, the Hollywood crowd, they think that the Dalai Lama is this prince of spiritualism. And he says that pre-1959 Tibet was a land of contentment. Well, it was not. It was not Shangri-La, but it was probably the closest thing to hell on earth that you had. Again, where many minor infractions would be punished by just lopping off the hand that offended. And if you protested against this, you'd be told, if you're a slave, if you're a serf, or even if you're just a woman, because women were very, very much oppressed, that was your own fault, because that was your misdeeds in your earlier lives that were coming back to haunt you. Bad karma. So therefore, social reform was impossible. It would have been frustrating divine retribution anybody a better deal. So that's the Dalai Lama. I think this is a bad deal for the American taxpayer.
Well, Mr. Tarpley, I want to thank you for weighing in on your theory, arguing that the Dalai Lama is in fact on the CIA payroll ahead of President Barack Obama's visit with the Dalai Lama.